Starting off today with something special. This is Iron House Brewery's Sweet Milk Stout from Iron House Brewing in Tasmania. You may remember this is one of the beers that Anthony sent me from from down under. I am still blown away that he actually did that and got away with it. Oh, that's very nice. Not quite as sweet as some of the stouts that they've been brewing locally. But the there's a little bit of hops in there, but it's not overpowering. Anyway, tonight I am going to do a teardown of this old beast here. Let me zoom out a bit. Once again, I've got something bigger than my disc. This is a branded Genial Scout XL16. It is a satellite dish motor controller. Oh, from back in the days when C-band, aka Big Ugly Dish Satellite TV, ruled the world. And to get any more than 24 channels, you had to physically move the dish. And that's the job of this guy, was to drive the motor that did that. A motor that looks a little bit like that one right there. So I probably should explain a little bit about this before we get going on. So the satellites, look, it's a planet. Satellites are arranged above the equator. This is looking from one of the poles, doesn't matter which one. But since I'm in the northern hemisphere, let's call that the North Pole. Works the same from the south, though. There's a bunch of satellites in geostationary orbits directly above the equator. They're 4 degrees apart in this angle here, I think is what they were anyways. For the most part, they were anyways, I'm pretty sure, back in the day. And so this is technology, this box here, and the C-band, or Big Ugly Dish satellites I'm talking about, were late 70s through the kind of 90s were their heyday. They were originally put up there for all kinds of communication. TV stations used them, and TV networks used them, and stuff like that. And then eventually they started getting used for direct-to-home broadcasts. But before they were officially used for direct-to-home broadcasts, some hobbyists grabbed a dish and were watching the network back feeds and news feeds and stuff like that. Anyway, I digress. So with the various satellites scattered above the equator and all the way around the world, except for above the oceans, because that's kind of pointless. There's nobody out there. But from any given place on the Earth, you could see a good number of them, but your dish could only point at one at a time. So to move the dish around and keep it pointing in the correct direction, you'd have a mount on the back of the dish at an angle, sort of an angle that points 90 degrees of that points towards the satellites above the equator. And then you mount your dish on there, and then to rotate around, it pivots on that angle. On that inclination, and then the motor drives that around so that it points at the different satellites, which is all well and good, but you have to have an idea of where they are. I mean, you could manually just crank it around, and you could buy manual cranks to do that, but who wants to do that if you're channel surfing? So that's where this guy and the motor comes in. Hopefully this angle will work for you. So here is the front panel of the thing. Over on the right-hand side, we have a selector knob for the different satellites. It's got 16. It doesn't have any sort of presets or anything from the factory. It's just up to 16 satellites. And then you can fine-tune that motor position a little bit. Or if you want to move it manually, you can just push it east or west to rotate it around. In the automatic mode, it follows these guys. In the manual mode, you just manually drive it, which is still easier than going out there and hand cranking it. Then here, it gives you just a numeric position. I don't think some of the fancier ones you could program to actually have the name of the satellite in them, but this one doesn't. And then there's a sort of a graphical LED bar graph that shows you relatively where you are, and a couple of arrows to show you if you're moving or not, or where you're moving. And then power, automatic, manual, locked, and search LEDs. Locked, I think, means that it's the dish has gotten to where it's going here. How does it know? Well, it's basically like a servo. So a servo is basically a motor that in this case drives a linear actuator, and coupled to that is a potentiometer, just a normal potentiometer that travels with the motion of this. So by reading that potentiometer, you can get a percentage of that motion, and then mechanical linkage makes sure that the full range of the potentiometer is the full range of the mechanical motion. And on this guy, you can see that here, there is just the DC inputs for the motor. And here is that potentiometer output that goes back to the unit to tell it where it is approximately. And this one also had a limit switch up at the end just to cut off the motor power should it hit the end before it realizes it. Which, if you're driving in manual mode and not paying attention, might be important. So anyway, around back of this guy, power input, 10-amp fuse, 3-amp fuse, and a 1-amp fuse. 10-amp fuse would be for the motor, 3 and 1-amp would be for different voltages, I'm guessing, inside there. Then we have 5 wires going to the actuator. 2 of them are going to be the motor, again a DC motor, and the other 3 are going to be that potentiometer and possibly the limit switch. I don't know. I've had this thing for decades and I never actually hooked it up. I bought it used. I moved before I could get it installed. And then under this little door here, we have 16 little potentiometers. You see those guys in there? Those set the position of the 16 presets on the front. So when you're installing it, you would use those to steer it around to the different satellites. Interesting analog way of going about it. So next I'm just going to pull the lid off this thing. It's got 4 screws, 2 over there and 2 over here. And then hopefully I'll be able to get it onto the bench so we can see what's inside it. Because that's the point of this exercise. We're going to be getting a lot of weird angles here just to get to actually see what's going on here. But I think that should pop open now. It screws off. There we go. So what do we have inside here? Immediately I can see 2 big relays, a serious power transformer, a slightly smaller one. There's the fuses down there, and simple marettes, aka some people call them wire nuts, holding all the AC mains wiring together. And that switches the mains directly. A big chunky full bridge rectifier down there. Wow. Looks like it's got some heatsink goop right onto the bottom of the case. So that's going to be, let's see now, where is that? That's coming straight off the power transformer. Okay. On the relay board, we've got a big 10 watt 1 ohm resistor. That's interesting. Are these socketed or are they... Oh, they look like got some glue on them. Okay. And then there's a couple of capacitors and a resistor, and that's about it on that board. Okay. Oh, and then there's an MOV over there, so that will be probably taking care of switching spikes and stuff. And a little ribbon cable coming from the front panel. And so now this other transformer over here looks like it's got... we got 5 secondary windings, and they all go over to this little board here. Oh, they're labeled. A 9 volt, a 0, a 9 volt, a 14 volt, and a 14 volt. Okay, so 0, is that going to be a shield ground, or is that going to be maybe a center tap? Something like that. Anyway, there's got 9 and 14 volts AC heading up that guy. Up to the main board. And we have this big chunky ribbon cable that goes from that board in the back with all the potentiometers up to the front. And I just noticed also going onto that is a ribbon cable that goes to 2 of the positions on the back here. So that's probably creating a voltage divider with the potentiometer. And this is another wire that goes from the outside terminal. Okay, so the 3 on that side, they're labeled black, gray, and red, are the potentiometer, and the yellow and green are the ones that drive the motor. You can see that those two are the wires coming from that relay board. Okay, so there's no real processing going on in the driving. The memory is all completely analog. Let's see if I can get this front panel off here. So there's a couple of screws in the corners and a couple in the bottom I can feel. Okay, well, that didn't do very much. And still kind of hampered by all these, but I notice there's a few screws on these boards too, so let's go at those. I mean, very few. I think there's only one on this one. In case you're wondering, I'm not intending for this thing to go back together. Okay, so here is that board that drives the motion. Haha, these big fancy buttons in the front. Same tactile switches as you can buy today. This guy down here is a voltage regulator. 7812, a classic if there ever was one. What else have we got on this board? Oh my goodness, what's over here? Some decent sized capacitors. 7812. LM7905, that's a 5 volt negative regulator. Okay, so we got plus and minus 5 volts. 7805 there. Is this 7805? 7805, yeah. So we got a couple of 5 volts, a minus 5 volts, and a 12 volt. Okay. And no doubt those capacitors for smoothing it. Got these funky old ribbon cables going off the board here. And so see these two guys underneath here? These are more full bridge rectifiers. See the markings on there? We got the AC coming in top and bottom and plus and minus coming out the sides. There's the plus there. So those will be in between these regulators over here and the transformer back there. This is that ribbon cable that comes in from the little transformer interface board down there. That ribbon's buggering off various different places. So this ribbon here is the one going off to the relay board that's actually driving the voltage out to the motor. So there's no real smarts or processing or anything else going on here. It's entirely analog. Although, what are these two chips over here? Well, it's got a Texas Instruments marking on it, but I cannot read what's going on there. This one, I can't even see the manufacturer label. Now, I'm not sure if those were scrubbed or if that's just worn off over time. They didn't take nearly as much care as some. I mean, this resistor sitting up at a wonky angle, so is that one. This diode here sticking up. Nothing's tight down to the board. These transistors are flopped over just to make clearance, I assume. Although, the high point, well, yeah, because there is the where the faceplate is, right where that the bottom of that pot is. So yeah, everything's got to be sunk down below that and these capacitors here, which is why all this stuff's lying down too. 1000 microfarad 25 volt filtering cap, and what is this one? I didn't look. 470, and these guys are, what are you, 220 microfarad. I'm assuming those guys are all pretty much the same. Anyway, so yeah, that's an interesting approach. The rectification and regulation for most of the voltages is actually up on this board. Although there's no weird fine little signal, so it doesn't matter that much. And so that's all that side. And this side over here is all, it's only display stuff. This is actually what's doing the driving. But for completeness and curiosity, I'm going to yoink that board out too. So this one has two large 7-segment LEDs there. A little pot beside it, which may or may not be for brightness, I'm not sure. And then this little bar graph up here, which just showed you relative east-west position, it is 4 5-segment LEDs. And all these resistors along here are no doubt the current limiting for those. These chips have got some funky stuff on them. Let's see if we can see what any of these are. This one over here by the 7-segment LEDs is an LM324, which is a quad op amp. And these guys, LM something, but they're not revealing their secrets. Again, I'm thinking that their printing has just faded over the decades. How old is this thing? 1998? Probably. Let's see if we can find anything on this main chip here. I'm not seeing anything. Well, that's disappointing. It's not really much to go on to determine the age of this thing. I'm going to guess that that is probably a display driver as well. Yeah, look at that. Most of its pins are going over to this guy here. Okay. So, not too much smarts going on there. We don't even really need this board. It's just displays. And I'm guessing that those two pots are the relative brightnesses. And these are just... what were they? They were just status, I think. Yeah, search, lock, manual, automatic, and power. Okay. So I wonder... Wonder what happens if I turn this, if I power this unit on. Okay, I've put two screws in just to hold these two boards vaguely in place. Let's see what happens. No explosions, that's a good thing. Now if you recall, there's mains up on that switch up there, so... okay, it still hasn't exploded. Are there any lights on the front panel? Looks like it. We're in manual mode and we've got power. We're on position 4. Oh, I wonder if that needs the potentiometer. Because turning the thing didn't seem to do anything. Well, let's just see if there's voltages in here. What voltages we got. And this is... supposed to be driving it in some direction or other, right? Not seeing any DC voltage there. Okay. I'm going to go back to AC volts and just check the voltages coming off of this transformer. Something is sizzling. Unplug that. Transformers aren't warm. Oh man, I can smell something now. Let me pull this front panel off and see if I can find it. But before I do, don't accuse me of being too stupid. Oh, I can definitely smell somebody was getting hot up here. Ooh, this was regulators. Oh, wow, okay. Ow. Damn it, what's hot? It's the back of those regulators got hot. Ooh, and our bridge rectifiers too. Ow! Son of a bitch. If I wanted to resurrect this thing, which I don't because I don't have any use for it, I would have to troubleshoot that power supply. But I think there is some good salvage value in here. These two big honking transformers and those relays. Well, that was interesting and fun and amusing and a bit of a trip down memory lane thinking about this old 70s and 80s satellite stuff. Anybody else remember that stuff from back in the day? Yeah, so questions, comments down below as usual. Thanks, Anthony, for the beer. I appreciate it. It's a good one. I will talk to you guys later.